Kangaroo, the hot new arcade game from Atari.
Welcome back, everyone. In our last episode, we delved deeper into the playfield and examined how it was used in a few classic games. In this episode, we're going to take a first look at drawing sprites and moving them around the screen. Trust me, if you're unfamiliar with the process, you're going to want to stick around. But first, a little history. Atari founder Nolan Bushnell came up with the original concept of sprite when developing the first video arcade game, Computer Space, in 1971. The rockets used in the game were bitmaps that moved around the screen independently of the background. The sprites were hardwired and controlled individually with a dedicated transistor, which allowed the background to be processed separately and the sprites to be composited together with the background by the hardware. Danny Hillis, an American inventor, entrepreneur, and scientist, coined the term sprites while working at Texas Instruments in the late 1970s. The label sprites was derived from the bitmaps floating around on top of the background without affecting anything below, much like a ghost, which can also be referred to as a sprite. The first commercial use of the term sprites was with the Commodore 64, which was released in August of 1982. Many game systems that followed would offer dedicated hardware sprites right up until 2004 with the Nintendo DS, which allowed up to 128 on the screen at the same time, at a maximum size of 64 by 64 pixels. The Atari VCS, with its limited resources, only offered 5 dedicated hardware sprites. A huge difference from the game systems that followed in their footsteps, but a big improvement to what was on the market at the time. Let's have a closer look at what we have to work with. The Television Interface Adapter, or TIA, on the Atari VCS provides us with the following hardware graphics registers for our sprites. The largest of them is the Graphics Player 0 and Graphics Player 1. Each of these registers are 1 byte, or 8 bits wide, with each bit representing a single pixel that is either visible or hidden. The other 3 graphics objects are even more limited, coming in at only a single bit per register. We have the Graphics Enable Missile 0 and 1, and the Graphics Enable Ball Register. Now, the height for these sprites don't work like you may think. On most machines, a sprite is a two-dimensional representation of a game object, like a player or a car, with both a width and a height. A static sprite that's 8 pixels wide by 8 pixels tall requires 64 bits, but on the Atari VCS, it's many times more bits than we have to work with. Here, each player is only 8 bits in total, and only represents a sprite that is 8 bits wide by 1 bit tall, a single scan line. Each bit of a graphic register takes a single TIA color clock to render, giving the player object graphics a higher resolution than we saw in the playfield graphics at 1/4 of the width. When it comes to moving the sprite around the screen, things get a little more interesting. On most other game systems or frameworks, we can place a sprite anywhere along the X or Y coordinates on the screen. We simply give it a position, and when it comes time to render the screen, the sprite manager blitz the sprite right where you told it to, usually on a screen buffer, and then the screen is rendered. It simply pushes that buffer to the screen all at once. This is technically impossible on the Atari VCS because A, it doesn't have a sprite manager, B, it doesn't have a screen buffer, and finally C, there are no XY coordinate system. There's only the color clock and the scan line. Drawing the sprite at a specific scan line is fairly easy. Generally, we're already counting the scan lines as we go, so we just wait until we get there to do what we want and then tell the TIA to draw it. This gives us our Y position, but placing it horizontally along the X position is another matter. You see, we need to tell the TIA when to draw the player graphics, as it's drawing the current scan line. As soon as we tell it to draw, it does so immediately, and then continues to draw at that position on every scan line forever, until you tell it to stop. It all comes down to timing. As we've learned before in a previous episode, the visible screen is 160 color clocks wide horizontally, or rather 76 machine cycles. If we want to draw our player graphics in a specific location on the screen, we need to wait a certain number of machine cycles. So what exactly is a machine cycle? They're the steps a processor executes for every instruction you give it. They are fetch, decode, execute, and store. The processor will first fetch the instruction from memory, decode the instruction into commands, execute that command, and then possibly store the results back in the memory. If we follow this piece of code, it simply counts down from 10. When the branch not equal instruction is executed, it checks if the zero flag has been set in the processor status register and branches accordingly. Using this as an example, we can get a feel for how many machine cycles are used per instruction. Here we can see that the load X instruction takes 2 machine cycles to assign the immediate value 10 to the X register. Decrementing X takes 2 machine cycles to execute. Branch not equal takes 2 machine cycles if a branch is not taken, and 3 machine cycles if it is taken. So let's try calculating how many machine cycles this loop uses. The first iteration will use 2 to load the value 10 into X, 2 to decrement X, and then 3 to jump back up to our loop point, using up 7 machine cycles. The second through ninth iterations will use 2 to decrement X and then 3 to jump back up to the loop point, using 5 machine cycles each loop, for a total of 40 machine cycles. The last iteration will use 2 to decrement X and then 2 on the branch not equal instruction, because the zero flag on the processor status register has been set, so it will continue execution with the next instruction that immediately follows it. This iteration only uses 4 machine cycles. Altogether, this simple loop uses 51 machine cycles. That's 67% of the time it takes to draw the visible screen. That's pretty tight, but luckily for us, we can stand on the shoulders of giants and learn the tips and tricks from over 40 years of game development on the Atari VCS. So now that we know the theory behind positioning player graphics horizontally on the screen, let's have a look at how this can be implemented. Today we'll only focus on placing graphics player 0 because it's a pretty big topic in all in itself. We'll follow up with other objects in a future episode, along with some of the modifiers available to change their appearance. As we've already mentioned, the graphics player 0 register is 8 bits, which represents the pixels used to draw a single scan line of our player. The other registers used to draw our player are as follows. Reflect player 0 is turned on by setting the D3 bit. When on, the bits in our player graphic will be reversed, meaning that it will use the least significant bit first. Setting D3 back to 0 will restore the bit ordering of the player back to using the most significant bit first. Reset player 0 sets the horizontal position of the graphics to the current position of the beam on that scan line. This is a strobe register, so writing any value to this address will set the position. Horizontal motion player 0 allows you to fine-tune the position of the graphic by up to 8 pixels to the right or 7 pixels to the left. Horizontal clear will clear all horizontal motion registers, including the player and missile for both players and the ball as well. This is a strobe register, so writing any value will clear the motion registers. Horizontal move will apply the fine-tuning set in the horizontal motion registers. This is a strobe register as well, so writing any value will apply the fine positioning. This should only be used directly after a WSync to ensure the operation starts at the beginning and finishes before the end of the horizontal blanking. With these 6 registers, you will be able to place your player graphics anywhere on the screen, in theory. But in practice, it's a little more complicated. Let's start with the graphics player 0 register. As we know, it's an 8-bit register representing 8 color clocks, or 8 pixels on the screen. It's fairly easy to work with because each bit is a single pixel. So if we load up the register with 8 bits binary, then we're assigning which bits will be drawn and which will be empty spaces. The color used for these bits can be assigned to the color player 0 register. In this case, we'll use white. Now we'll just strobe the reset player 0 register. A strobe register is a trigger that is activated when any value is written to it. So in this case, we'll just store whatever value happens to be in the accumulated register. This will trigger the TIA to start writing our layer graphics to the screen, wherever the beam currently is on the scan line. Or more precisely, it will be drawn after the 6507 interprets our instructions and the TIA prepares to draw. This takes about 5 color clocks in all. If we execute this code, we can see a couple of things here. First is the position of the graphics. Since we didn't take into account any timing at all, it was placed on the screen where the bean happened to be at the time. If we want a bit more control, we'd place a WSync right before we call reset player 0. There we go, now it's positioned at the left side of the screen. It's a few color clocks away from the edge, and there's a reason for that, but we'll cover that in a moment. The second thing we need to observe is that the player graphic is being displayed on all scan lines at exactly the same place. This is because the TIA will continue drawing the player graphics in the exact same place until you tell it to stop. It maintains this horizontal position because the TIA stores this timing in an internal register. As we saw moments ago, strobing reset player 0 right after a WSync sets the position of the graphic close to the left side of the screen. In fact, if we strobe the register at any point during the horizontal blank period, which is the first of 68 color clocks of a scan line, then this is exactly where the player graphic will be drawn. However, if we introduce a little delay after the WSync to bring us to a point after the horizontal blank, then we can position it further away from the left side. We can do this in our code by using the macro function sleep. All this does is tell the assembler to insert a number of no-op instructions into the binary file. A no-op instruction is just that, no operation. It just wastes machine cycles, more specifically, 2 machine cycles. Just provide the sleep macro function with the number of machine cycles you want to waste, and the function will insert the appropriate number of no-op instructions. It's important to note, however, that the sleep function is not practical for your game code, nor can you change the number of machine cycles it uses while your code is running. This is only used to pad your code with a specific number of machine cycles and can't be changed later. So let's change the number we're passing to the sleep function and see what happens. Anything that is 19 and below will take place during horizontal blank, so we need to set it after that. So let's try 20. We can see that it's moved over to the right by 3 color clocks, or 3 pixels. Increasing this number even more, we can move it all the way over to the right. So, the question you may be asking yourself right now is, if each instruction moves by 3 color clocks, is that the smallest move you can make? It seems a little choppy to me. And the answer to that is no. The smallest you can make is actually 15 color clocks. You see, you can't write a game using the sleep function to move your player graphic because it can't ever change. Your graphics will always be in the same place and just not a fun game. In order to place the player graphic where we want it on the screen, we'll need to create a routine that uses up a variable amount of machine cycles. What we need is a loop. This is as basic as it gets. First, we set the position we want to draw the player graphic in X, and then we decrement by 1. If the decrement results in a 0, then the 0 flag on the processor status register will be set, and then branch not equal will exit the loop. If it's not, then execution will branch back to the loop label. It's such a simple loop, taking only 5 machine cycles, 2 to decrement the X register, and 3 to take the branch back up to the start of the loop. Since there are 3 color clocks per machine cycle, this leaves us with a granularity of 15 color clocks. Now we can move the player graphic around the screen. Still, that would be a pretty boring game if we had to jump around like that. Luckily, the TIA can help fill in the gaps, quite literally. The architects of the TIA provided the ability to overcome the limitations of a 15 color clock granularity with the horizontal move player 0 register, or HMP0 for short. It allows the TIA to adjust the graphic player 0 to the left by 7 color clocks, or to the right by 8 color clocks, or not to adjust the position at all. This is an 8-bit register, but only uses the 4 high bits to specify the adjustment you want to make. Looking at this chart, we can see that setting all 4 bits to 0 will disable any adjustments, but setting it all to ones will adjust the player graphic one color clock to the right of the course position we set while strobing reset player 0. The value stored in horizontal move player 0 will remain until you change it. However, the adjustment will not be applied until you strobe another register called horizontal move. Horizontal move should only be strobed during horizontal blanking, so you should do this immediately after a W-sync. Strobing horizontal move will also move all the other graphics that have had their horizontal adjustment register set, like the other player, missiles, and ball graphics. Taking a look at the third example for this episode, we're first setting the X register with all 4 of the high bits set, which will move a graphic by one color clock to the right. Then down on our main loop, we strobe their horizontal move register right after the W sync. Doing this, we're strobing horizontal move on every frame, moving the graphic by one color clock each time. What we observe here is that the TIA remembers where the player graphic was last positioned, and then applies the adjustment to that position, moving the graphic across the screen in a smooth scroll, one pixel at a time. The best part about this is that we only set the player graphic's position once in the initialization of the code, and then use the player graphic's horizontal move register to move it around the screen, taking only 3 machine cycles per frame. Now we have the capability to position a player graphic anywhere horizontally on the screen, but playing with a long line on the screen still isn't very interesting after a while, no matter how smoothly it scrolls. But with a little trickery, we can turn what we have now into something a little more interesting. We'll examine the code to this in the next episode, but it's available right now in our Git repository. Check it out. In this episode, we've only focused on the graphic player 0 object, but everything we've covered so far works about the same for the graphics player 1, both player missiles, and the ball graphics. Next episode, we'll also cover the other objects, size modifiers, creating bitmaps for our objects, and sprucing them up with a little color. If I piqued your interest in developing for the Atari VCS, please let me know by liking and sharing this video. And if you haven't done so already, please consider subscribing to the channel. We're slowly growing together, and I'm really looking forward to what we can become. As always, the example code for this episode and all the previous episodes are available in our Git repository, which is linked into the description below. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you next time.
We're Atari. We have the vision, and we invented the technology to bring the excitement home to you.